Go ahead.
Excellent. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. Good evening, everybody. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us today in our webinar series. Such an honor to have a special guest that is going to be engaging you in a very engaging topic, an interesting topic. Let me first run you through a welcoming deck of slides that we have prepared for PMI UAE chapter. Your host for today is Mazen Gadir. I'm the PMI UAE chapter outreach director, as well as during the day, I work as a director in a company called IQVIA in the digital health space. So such an honor to be your host for today. So let's move on. PMI UAE chapter, let's talk about our mother association, Project Management Institute, based out of Philadelphia with over 300 chapters worldwide, over 600,000 members and 2 million credential holders. Such a huge organization, non-for-profit, volunteer-based. So in the UAE, we are around 2,200, all the thanks to our members who have joined us and to our wonderful volunteers who have put this together and our wonderful guests who have volunteered to join us with the amazing content. So the PMI UAE chapter is proud to be in the top 5% chapters globally. We are very passionate about project management, is our bread and butter. And we are here representing multiple industries. We are dependent on you. So please, if you are thinking about renewing your membership, I would definitely advise you to continue doing that. And also, if you are interested in volunteering opportunities, bringing your organizations to partner with our non-for-profit volunteer-based chapter, we are more than happy to reach out to your organizations in multiple with our multiple capabilities and capacities. Just to give you an understanding of our benefit landscape, and we have actually spoken to our members. We've heard the voice of our members, and we've come up with this slide. And these are some of the benefits packages that we have been producing and preparing for our members in the UAE chapter specifically. And hence, that's what we'd love you to have. We would love to have you stay with us again on annual basis. Networking capabilities and benefits, the facts that we are bringing you the best and the latest knowledge and experts from around the world, like today's guest. It's an opportunity for you to network, to learn, and to engage with an organization very well reputed like the one I'm just about to introduce. And learning and knowledge sharing is one of our major core pillar, where knowledge is our focus area in terms of webinars, in terms of publications, in terms of getting all the leaders of knowledge together at your fingertips. Career growth, definitely, networking, and 90% or 95% on average, they say, you get a job offering through networking. And hence, we need to provide you with the networking opportunities to grow your career, make sure that you have the certification you require in the project management field, and finally, organize the events, webinars, and whatnot as we go through this wonderful journey with the PMI. Obviously, our sponsors, we have a local representation in our wonderful country of UAE that has been sponsoring us and supporting us. We are obviously opening our doors and hands for all other sponsors who would like to be part of the family through sponsorships, through MOUs or partnerships. We are definitely more than happy to speak to you. Before I forget, our hearts and prayers go to our beloved people and brothers and sisters in Lebanon and across the world, specifically amongst this pandemic that has been taking us to the new norm. So I just wanted to send my prayers and my heartfelt, warm greetings to all of the families that have lost all the blessings upon them and their loved ones. So to continue with our webinar, I'd love you to follow us on our website or through the social media outlets. Don't hesitate to reach out throughout our social media outlets. We have representation and existence in LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, as well as YouTube and Instagram. So for this webinar, please make sure that you claim 2 PDUs, as mentioned in this slide. And this will apply to you if you attend at least 80% of the webinar. And make sure that you feel free to engage with the panelists and the speaker of today. And then if you have any questions in regards to your PDUs, if you don't get them within a week or two, please reach out to us to actually alert us or give us send us your concern about the PDUs, and then we will work on it. Okay, so our speaker today, he brought in a very dynamic topic, and the topic is about dynamic risk assessment and management. Very well-reputed organization, Bart Van Loon. I would love you to connect with him on LinkedIn. Comes from KPMG with a vast experience spanning over 20 years in KPMG. Very impressive. Bart himself, and I've put some extracts for you in this next slide, has been leading multiple pillars within KPMG, from forensic and integrity to lead major projects advisory to audit risk compliance. And then at the moment, he's obviously chairman at KPMG for forensic and internal audit risk and compliance services. Well, very illustrious and well established career growth in KPMG. I haven't gone in his LinkedIn, but it's very well established. I'd love you to go connect with him. Comes with a very good background and educational rich depth as well. So with this, I would love you to allow me to introduce our wonderful speaker, Bart Van Loon, and I will switch to his presentation as he takes the mic. Mr. Bart?
Yeah, thank you very much, Mazin, and thank you very much for the opportunity to have KPMG presenting on this very interesting topic. I fully agree that within project management, there's quite a lot of things going on. And as you can see from my CV, I have a very broad background. I am a forensic auditor, so doing quite a lot of forensic investigations. I'm responsible for internal audit and risk management. I'm globally also the network leader for enterprise risk management itself. But if you see this broad variety of activities that I do within KPMG for already quite a long time, then it's one specific topic that is always there, and that's being in control. I like to be in control. I like to be in control myself. I like to be in control of projects. I like to support clients to be in control of their organization. I even like that organizations are in control of their employees. So also the cultural elements of it is also what I like. And unfortunately, I often have to investigate organizations or projects that ultimately appear to be not in control, and then I have to search for the root causes. And based on that, I've learned a lot in my career within KPMG, and that what I learned, I'm trying to leverage towards our clients in order to prevent things from happening. And that's also something I really would like to discuss today with you as well. So thank you very much for the invitation. I know that there are some colleagues also in this webcast being present. So if you have some specific questions to us, then we're more than happy to answer those. But what would I like to cover with you? So if we can go to the next slide, which is the agenda. I really would like to talk you through a new way of looking at risk management. And I would like to explain you a little bit about the concept of the new way of risk management. And that that basically started in last crisis, in the financial crisis in 2008. Based on that, we have seen that the current way to look at risk management is not sufficient anymore. So that's and these insights I really would like to share with you. Then I would like to, because it's nice to have a theoretical story about risk management and how it should evolve, but it's always better to talk about specific cases. So So I brought with you two cases. One is already connected to the COVID situation. We did a kind of a survey assessment on risks that currently cities are facing related to the topic of COVID. And we did a risk assessment based on that in the new methodology. And I really would like to share some ideas and suggestions and outcomes of that with you to see how you can put this in practice. I also have a case which I've actually done myself in the Netherlands with a gas transition project. I'll talk about it later. And the last part of the presentation relates to soft controls. And soft controls might seem to be calling, we call it soft, but I also would like to show you that soft controls are pretty hard and hard controls are pretty soft. And what that means, I hope to explain to you also in this webcast. So that's the agenda. And of course, we have plenty of time to have some Q&As. So I really would like to start talking about dynamic risk assessment now, and you can immediately go to the next slide. And I see that unfortunately the layout is now a little bit changing, but yeah, hopefully you can see it. I mentioned that dynamic risk assessment is a new way of looking at risk because something happened in 2008. We had some partners in KPMG being responsible for, in this case, financial institutions. And then the financial crisis started, and they basically had clients that calculated the impact of risks for a few billion euros as maximum risk exposure. And after the crisis, it was not only a few billion risks that they were exposed to. The ultimate loss were hundreds of billions, which means that they were completely way off when they calculated their risk exposure. And this partner, which is actually based in Australia, currently he's in the UK, made a very fundamental decision in his career. He said, you know, risk management, the way we approach it is fundamentally wrong, but I don't know what to do with that. And also I don't have a solution. And he decided to resign as a KPMG partner. And he basically went back to university. He went to the best mathematical universities in China and US. And he was studying risk management. So that's how it all started. That's nice, because what happened is that the world around us is changing, and changing quite rapidly. And we are experiencing it also today. Unfortunately, I cannot be with you. And normally I would fly, step into an airplane and be there together with you and do a presentation there. That's not possible because of all the things that we are experiencing. But in a classical way, looking at risk, it all started with financial risks. Financial risks, because you don't want to have a financial loss. That's also how it relates to projects. You don't want to have a bleeder in your projects. So financial control and financial risks is where most companies focused on quite heavily. That's already classical, especially after the crisis of Enron. The Sarbanes-Oxley legislation came in. So also corporates focused on SOCs and those kind of. So financial control is probably the most well-developed area. But at the same time, it's not about only financial risks, it's also your operational activities that are at risk as well, especially when you talk about projects. Those are the operational risks that you have to deal with. So also there, we see that operational risk and operational risk management is also maturing quite a lot, which is also very logical, but also approached sometimes in a different way than financial risks. Then we see that in the last years, there's an increased level of compliance and regulatory pressure towards organizations, but also towards projects. So also there you see new compliance officers coming in, doing risk assessments, putting some measures to mitigate those risk factors as well. So also there you see a separate stream entering the organization, entering into projects where you have to deal with as well. So you have financial risk, you have operational risk, you have compliance risks. But then we also see that a lot of organizations are now focusing on digitalization. So a lot of standardized processes are now digitalized. So everything goes into not Excel sheets anymore. So we have toolings, we have artificial intelligence, We are using robots and robotization techniques. So that also is nice to optimize policy processes. But at the same time, it comes also brings other risks. If you digitalize everything, then also, for example, the risks of cybersecurity increases and also these types of things. So new risks are also introduced. And that creates even more complexity. What also creates more complexity is the geopolitical and macroeconomic trends. There's quite a lot of things going on in the world at the moment. Of course, there's some civil unrest. So, for example, we just talked about Beirut, and that's on the left side. Also, I put in some pictures also with intention. Of course, it's heavy, and it's also my thoughts are with them as well. But also, you see immediately after that event, you see that there's also civil unrest starting up because people are complaining about the government. That's the same what happened in France. In the US, you see with the Trump administration, you see a lot of things happening also related to China. So you see quite a lot of political events popping up, geopolitical risks that you also have to deal with, also as a company, even in a project. So that's really, really heavy. We didn't touch upon the sustainability risks. Sustainability risks, everybody talks about, for example, the black swan. So everybody knows a black swan. You always have a black swan. Sometimes people call the COVID situation a black swan, which is not, because a black swan is a risk that you that can always happen and that you don't foresee. The sustainability risk is what we call currently the green swan. And what's the difference between a black and a green swan? The green swan is a risk that you know that's going to happen, but you're not acting upon it. So you know that sustainability risks will ultimately impact companies and heavily, but a lot of organizations don't do anything about it yet because they are still thinking that the old economy, that the old way of doing business will still help to save them, which probably is not. And it also comes with climate change, pandemics, natural disasters. We all know that in Australia last year there was a lot of bushfires, even reducing the economy, the economic activities, also now bringing down projects, but also the COVID situation also has a huge impact. And why do I tell this all? I tell you this because if you look to a company or you look to an organization or even you look to a project, the complexity of all the things that happen is immense. And as a project manager or a risk manager, you have to deal with all this all these events. And that's complicated and that's difficult. And you might miss something. And if you miss something, you are immediately at risk. So that's the complexity that we see happening. Then you have to have an answer, how to stay in control. And that's where dynamic risk assessment comes in. So maybe we can go to the next slide.
Oh, yes.
Sorry. Because the classical way of looking at risk is still that you focus on impact and likelihood. So we all know those pictures, impact likelihood, I don't know how you look at those pictures, but often you then focus on the right top-hand corner, so the fourth quadrant, where the high impact, high likelihood risks are basically considered, because those are the risks that you really would like to focus on. But also what you do with these types of risk assessments is that you basically assess those risks based on historical information. If you work in a financial institution, you use models, and those models are built up with historical data based on the past. But what we also know is that the future is different with all these technological developments, with these sociological and political changes. Yeah, we never had a Trump administration. We never had a blast like in Beirut. We never had those fires in Australia. Because we had SARS, but we never had a COVID situation basically bringing down the whole global economy. So that means that there are events happening in the future, and that goes faster than in the past, where the historical data and the historical experience is not a good forecaster. So the past is not a forecaster for the. So then you need to have a different approach. Impact likelihood is also considering that risks are always in isolation, so that a specific risk you can mitigate by having a specific measure on that specific risk. And we also found out that risks are never in isolation. Risks are always connected, and the one risk is triggering the other risk. What we currently see in Beirut, for example, is that we had the blast, and of course that's a risk that can always happen. But what we see now, and that's pretty interesting from a risk perspective, is that we now see that also the society is really, really aggressive and really angry towards the government. And you see that there's now a kind of a movement starting up, which nothing has to do with the blast, but the blast was the trigger of other things that are going to happen. So it's very interesting to see what that means. Also, for example, I'm not sure whether you know that, but there was a case at United Airlines. United Airlines, it was a few years ago, there was one person that was misbehaving in the airplane. And then one of the stewards, I think, took him out of his seat and pushed him on the floor. And that was recorded. And that movie circulated in social media. I don't think that's a big risk. There's always something happening in an airplane, especially now when with these masks and people refusing to wear a mask. So you see that also now popping up quite a lot. But that instance does not damage the company as a whole. But what happened is that the CEO of United Airlines also reacted in the news the day after, saying that the behavior of his steward was good behavior because somebody was misbehaving, and that was not accepted by society. Included with some other remarks that this CEO made, also was bringing down the stock prices of United Airlines very drastically, also bringing United Airlines in a very difficult situation. So then you see that one event combined with another event triggered another event, and that in combination is a risk for the company. And that's where dynamic risk assessment is going into, which means that we are going to add to impact and likelihood two other components, and those other two components are connectivity, what I just explained. So risks are always connected with each other. So you have to know how are risks connected to each other and which risks are connected to each other, because not all risks are connected to each other. And also the velocity is important as well. So it's also important to know how much time do you have to react. Because if you only have a few hours or a few days to react, then you need to implement different measures than if you have a year to react. But you can also imagine that if you have a cluster of interconnected risks, that also the response time is also different. So that's the concept of dynamic risk assessment. So from a two-dimensional approach, impact likelihood or impact and severity, you go towards impact, severity, velocity, and interconnectivity. So that's how it is. So that's what I would like to show in the next slide. So the concept basically shows that you're looking into your risk landscape to connected risks. And those connected risks we call clusters of risks. And the combined cluster can also show that the individual risks in combination as a cluster have a higher impact and a higher severity or even likelihood compared to the individual risks. And also sometimes risks that are on the low end corner in impact likelihood, so low impact, low likelihood, combined with some other risks in aggregate could be of higher risk than the risk which is in the fourth quadrant. So that's how we look at dynamic risk assessment here. So clusters are important. Maybe go to the next slide. Because the next one, because we did this, because it's nice to have a kind of a theoretical story about risk management, and at the same time also looking to the chat to see whether there are some questions already popping up. But it's always better to have a kind of an example which makes it probably more concrete, and that's the example of looking to the COVID situation and currently the risks that cities are facing related to COVID, because you don't want to be the city that is ultimately the city which is the source of a new outbreak of the COVID pandemic. So of course we are seeing now globally that in a lot of countries now the COVID is really getting bigger again, and we are trying to mitigate this. But at the same time, you don't want to be the city. Yeah? So, for example, in Paris, I think it's quite risky at the moment. So they are taking additional measures. But we did a kind of assessment related to these cities, and then we also found out that the most severe and likely risks that cities currently are facing, and if you look at this picture, hopefully you can see it, that on the right-hand corner, that the economic crisis was still the risk that most cities are have to deal with, because that immediately is impact. For example, in Amsterdam, where I live, we have a company, a very big company, which is called Booking.com. Now, Booking.com is heavily impacted by Corona, which also means that they are going to reduce the number of employees at Booking. Yeah, that immediately has an impact on the employment rate within the Amsterdam community. Also, the attractiveness of Amsterdam as a global global city attracting international people can be impacted. So an economic crisis can have impact on a city. So that's on the right hand corner. But then the question is this now the biggest risk that cities have to face and have to deal with? And then you see that there are some other risks which also have a high degree of severity, and that's for example funding availability, inequitably effects of the pandemic, the pandemic health responses, but also trust, leadership and politics, risk management and crisis planning. These are all risks that we have assessed during a kind of a risk assessment, which are also really risks that we have to deal with. But in a classical old-fashioned picture, this is the picture that you see then. And then you also think, okay, I have to focus on economic crisis, we have to reduce that. But then the question is, what can you do about it? And there's a nice document written by KPMG. The link is over there. I think we're going to share the slides with you, so you can also find this this document. But if you go to the next slide, then we also see that some risks are more connected than other risks, and we made some risk clusters, bringing together combined levels of risk. And then also made a kind of a calculation: how much time do we have to did we have to react to that? And then you see that out of the 18 risks that we had, that there are seven specific risks that are connected in the strongest risk clusters. And these risks are the economic crisis, of course, civil unrest. And civil unrest, as you can see, is all the way to the left side. Yeah? So it's a medium risk from a likelihood perspective. It still has high severity, but maybe civil unrest was not a topic that was top of mind when you looked at the old-fashioned picture. But civil unrest in a cluster with some other risks is of higher importance to manage than the other risks. So that's the outcomes of this assessment. And then we can go to the next slide, for example. What you see in this picture is that if you know a risk cluster, and that's important to mention, is that you have also risks that are influencing other risks, and you have risks that are influenced by other risks. And that's what we call the risk emitters and the risk receivers. So you have risks that are triggered by other risks, and you have triggers that are triggering other risks. And that's important to know, because the quality of a risk assessment, when you perform a dynamic risk assessment, will improve heavily knowing risk clusters, but also knowing what in the risk cluster is the most important risk that is triggering the other risk. Because if you know that trigger risk, that's the risk that you have to manage very heavily. That's the risk that you have to allocate to the highest ranked officer or the highest ranked project manager in your project, because that's what you absolutely have to get right. If you can de-escalate that risk, then it immediately de-escalates the whole cluster of risks. And can you imagine what that means? That also means that you also can reduce the controls that you have to allocate to the other risks. So also reducing the cost of control. And that makes this assessment and this way of risk management very effective and very cost effective. So what you can see right here is that, and we're talking about cities here, so we see that one of the most important risk emitters is trust, leadership, and politics. And we didn't see that in the initial document, in the initial picture, but we saw there's some background noise, which I hear now with some voices, so maybe people can put themselves on mute. So trust and leadership and politics is the trigger of a lot of other risks. And that means that if you are responsible for a city, that this is the element that you have to work on, because that trust and leadership element is ultimately the most influencing factor to trigger an economic crisis. And that's interesting to know. So if you focus a lot of attention to good leadership, the right politics, being transparent, organizing trust within your city, organizing trust towards your entrepreneurs in the city, then that helps to mitigate the risk economic crisis. And that's an important one, which came out of this city component. And of course, when there's an election going on, people can really make these types of choices so that they know exactly what to do. So that's what we did with cities. It gives you a little bit of a clear a picture how we work with this. And I really would like to go to the next case that I worked on myself as well, and that's the gas transition project. For example, not for example, but in the Netherlands, our economic wealth is based on the gas wells that we have in the Netherlands. So we produce quite a lot of gas in the Netherlands. Our complete wealth in the Netherlands is based on that. So we're pretty proud on that. And that's and the wells are pretty close to the north part of the Netherlands. That's not where the economic activity is. It's in the north part. But the last 3 or 5 years, more and more earthquakes happened. So which ultimately resulted into some damaged houses, because these earthquakes also increased in magnitude, and also resulted into an insecurity of the people actually living there, and they didn't feel safe anymore. So, and this is pretty sensitive, because so there was a lot of unrest in that part of the Netherlands, and the Netherlands is not that big, but. And they also always felt, you know, we are in the north. There's not a lot of economic activity here. So you used our ground to and the well to make a lot of profit, but now we are confronted with a lot of damage and we are not compensated for that. So there was a lot of political unrest in that specific part of the Netherlands. And also the earthquakes, as I mentioned, increased the magnitude. So there was also a lot of safety problems. But Shell and other companies were basically behind this. And they, of course, made a lot of money out of it. And the Dutch government made a very important decision to, and that's the reason for gas transition, to stop and to cease gas production in the Netherlands, which is a huge decision because economically, this has had a lot of consequences. But for the society, it was important. So they needed to go into a transition, which also comes with a lot of risks. But they also, at the same time, had to go into another project and compensate the people that owned houses and owned buildings to compensate for the damage. So we were asked by the Dutch government to perform a risk assessment on this. And they asked for a dynamic risk assessment because they also said, you know, we don't have historical evidence. We don't have experienced earthquakes in the past. So basically, we don't know what to do. We never had a gas transition project because we never had it. So we need to do a different way of looking at risks. And then we stepped into this assessment. And we came up with a lot of interesting insights that I really would like to share with you because it was completely different than what they expected originally. Maybe if we can go to the next slide, because I was already talking about that slide. So I already explained to you a little bit of the background and the challenges. So no data. And of course, because it's in a political sensitive environment, also there, it's very important. One thing I also want to mention here is that because you don't have historical data and you want to know, okay, what are the risks? What is the connectivity? There has to be a new way to deal with that. And that's also what you can use in projects. Because in projects, there are always people with a lot of experience saying, I knew this. I knew that this risk was going to happen. But nobody asked me. So there's always people, we call it the gray-haired, old, grumpy, cynical people that always have an opinion about something. Those are the people that you would like to leverage from. You would like to give them a kind of a platform to raise their voice and to include their ideas, their suggestions, their way how to look at risks into a scientifically proven approach. And that's what we call expert elicitation. And that's an important word. Expert elicitation is a technique that is replacing models and is replacing historical data. And also, and that's what my colleague that ultimately decided to resign as a partner in KPMG and went back to university, and he studied quite a lot on that. And he basically found out that the concept of expert elicitation is as equal as financial models from a reliability perspective. We think it's better, but scientifically we cannot prove it. So we say it's scientifically equal, but we think and we prove that it's better, especially when you have to forecast a risk in the future where you don't know what's going to happen because you don't have the historical data. That's the same what Barack Obama did, US Prime President, when he had to predict fighting wars, because also fighting a war is also different now than in the past. It's not a soldier at a border trying to steal a piece of land anymore. It's now probably a student sitting somewhere in Germany with his mother, with his parents at home behind a computer, doing an attack on behalf of, for example, Russia in France, doing a cyber attack, but we don't know. So that means that fighting wars is completely different. And Barack Obama decided to use the concept of expert elicitation to predict risks from happening. And he called them the super forecaster. So he used super forecasters in a scientific way to predict what's going to happen. And that's exactly what we did also in this guest transition project, is we identified super forecasters within the Dutch government, also outside of the government, and we included all their responses in a very structured way with a lot of data. And we asked basically, okay, what do you consider as the most important risks? What do you think about impact? What do you think about likelihood? What do you think about velocity? But also, what do you think about the connectivity of the risks? And if you do that in a scientifically way, which is included in the KPMG approach, then there's an outcome, and then you come up with clusters, and these clusters are really interesting. Because what appeared to be the outcomes of this this project is that, of course, you had the classical risks that were popping up in the impact likelihood picture. But after identifying the, because we identified the three most important clusters, we were able to allocate the mitigating actions towards the three different parts of the society, basically. So the first cluster was basically that the government, the central government in the Netherlands, had to work on putting their act together, because a lot of responsibilities were split between the different ministries. So there was no clarity and there was no clear guidance on what to do. So there was a lot of discussion and a lot of politics going on, which didn't contribute to specific risks. So central government, get your act together. That was one of the most important risk clusters that we identified. Another risk cluster was, because it was in the north of the Netherlands, we also identified that the local governments, so local provinces, but also local cities and local, they all, they were not that well educated. They didn't have the experience that was at the central level. So they also made a lot of mistakes. So also getting their act together and a lot of risks focused around that, that was also a specific cluster that we were able to identify and also identify mitigating measures there as well. And the third risk cluster related to the society as a whole. So the society, the people actually living there that had damaged houses, that that didn't really feel safe because of the earthquakes, that was also a risk cluster that was triggering quite a lot of risks. And also there, we were able to identify specific measures going forward. So that was that was a really interesting outcome of it. So we did this assessment, and maybe we can go to the next slide, because I think I covered that as well. So the dynamic risk assessment gave better insights in risks, the risks that they already knew, and of course we did a classical risk assessment with them, but then we brought in connectivity and velocity, which resulted into more risk clusters, identifying the different stakeholders of these risk clusters, and we were able to appoint the right owners of these clusters in order to take ownership of the mitigating measures. And that's also what you can do within a project. Within a project, doing a risk assessment, identifying the risk clusters, maybe the scheduling is part of a trigger that triggers other risks. So if you know that that's the trigger, you immediately have to identify that activity and allocate it to the right person. If it's a risk on the receiving end, so it's a risk which is triggered by somebody else, then you might ask not the project manager, but maybe somebody lower in the organization to deal with this risk and run scenarios so that they practice. That they practice if something happens and this risk is triggered, that they exactly know what to do. Like fire prevention, if you know what to do when the fire starts, then you are prepared when something happens. And that's also what you would like to do with the risks that are on the receiving end. So the triggers, you have to de-escalate. The risks that are on the receiving end in the cluster, you have to do rehearsing and practicing and doing scenario analysis in order to train yourself to be well prepared once something happens. So that's what I wanted to focus on. What you also can see, and that's on the left side of this picture, is that that we also performed a risk culture assessment. And that's an important one as well. And that's also a bridge towards the other topic that I would like to cover, is that you can deal with risks, but ultimately it's the people that working in these projects that are the real risks. Because if they don't do the right thing, if they don't understand it, or they don't have the time to deal with it, then they might be the ultimate risk. And that's important to do. So also, if people don't, if people understand the risk, but they have a different view on the risk, and there are multiple views on the same risk, and it's not clear what is actually meant with the risk, then you might run into the risk that you expect that somebody is having the same view on that specific risk like you have, and that they also deal with that in the same way. But if that's not all clear, then you run the problem that that everybody thinks they are doing the right thing, but it's not aligned and it's going probably in the opposite direction. So this culture assessment was also an important element to come up with the right mitigating actions to also work on the culture. And one of the elements that we also brought on the table, because this is a project organization, and as you can imagine, this, because this is very sensitive in the Dutch politics, all the high educated smart people are in this work group, in this team, but they also get bored pretty easily. So when, for example, COVID started, and it also impacted, of course, the government, a lot of those people wanted to be on that project because they really liked a new project with a lot of new energy. And that was a risk, because you also would like to have some consistency in the earthquake team. And that's also what we found out as a cultural element, that there was a large team that was really going for the thrills and the excitement. But also in this project, you need to also have people in the team that are doing repetition, quite boring stuff in order to mitigate the risk. I don't see my slide. Yeah, and then maybe we can immediately go to the next one as well. Yep. I really would like to touch upon briefly the hard and soft control, so the cultural elements. Also, there are some colleagues in the call. We worked quite intensively also on some major projects, infrastructure projects that didn't go that well. And then ultimately, we found out that there's often a human factor, the root cause of things that didn't happen. And the reason is, and that's the house which you see on the left side, is that there's always risks. So there's always risks that are impacting your objectives. And of course, in a project, you can have your project objectives. That can be that you have to finish your project within the cost or within the budget agreed, which is often the case. But also, probably you work on the most innovative project and you really would like to have a showcase project. So then the objective is something different, because you would like to bring in innovative approaches and new methods and techniques. So there are different methods, different reasons, different objectives that you can have in a project. And these also come always with different risks. And these risks you really would like to encounter. And what you see, and that's also my experience as a forensic auditor, is that there's often a lot of focus on policies and procedures, segregation of duties, processes, so risk management policies, documents, signing off on documents, Which is pretty logical, but then we still fear that there's still a lot of things go wrong. And I, when I did forensic investigations on projects with huge project overruns, sometimes even tripled the budget, then they always ask me, "Hey, how is it possible?" Because we had policies and procedures in place. Everybody was trained, so they knew what to do. There was management, there was oversight, there was financial control. So how is it possible that still things go wrong? And then the conclusion always is, yeah, it's ultimately the people that work in these projects. And the people didn't always follow the procedures as we expected them to follow. And then it's interesting to understand, okay, but what is the reason why they didn't follow it? Because they often, because if they do it intentionally, and then it's a fraud, or then, but often they also still thought that they were still following the procedures, or they were still following the instructions of management, and that's also a scientific method, because we have a business ethics professor in our own team in the Netherlands. He is a professor in business ethics at the University of Rotterdam. And he developed a methodology to look at culture a little bit more fundamental. And that's the next slide. And these are 8 components of behavior that you really would like to understand. Can you go to the next slide, please? Within behavior, we call it the risk culture model. It's important for people, and there are 3 components. So you have preventive measures, detective measures, and responsive measures, that you organize controls, cultural controls, to increase clarity. What do I mean with that? Is that it's for everybody clear what they expect, what you expect from them in a project. So, okay, if you do risk management, if you have to complete with a certain procedures, what is actually expected from you? Is it expected from you that if you see that things go wrong, is it expected from you that you speak up, or is it expected from you that you first solve it? And that's a huge difference, because if it's expected from you that you first solve it, then probably it's too late to do something with it if it's too late. So probably it's better that people speak up. And so clarity about policies, procedures, and creating clarity is also important. What I also experience within project is that you often have the project owner, the project taker, there are construction workers, there are some architects. So there's a lot of stakeholders that all have a different agenda in this project. And it's not always clear what their agenda is, what their stake is, what their objective within the project is. And what I always call it, when you negotiate a contract, then you're trying to negotiate, but ultimately you sign a contract. And once you sign the contract, it's like signing a marriage. So it's a signing a marriage. So you agree on the common objective that you all have. But what we see, and that's that difference around the globe. So in Germany, it's quite different compared to, for example, the Netherlands. But once you sign the contract, a construction contract, the day after the construction contract is signed in Germany, you immediately you get a claim for additional work. So there's always a change order coming the day after in Germany. That's not in the Netherlands, but in Germany, it's immediate. But then it goes outside of each other. So you sign a contract, and the day after, it seems to be that the objectives differ. And creating clarity in a project is essential. So understanding, okay, you want to go for the most cost-effective way to deal within this project. That's fine. It's good to know. The other party in the project might be, no, I want to learn in this project, because ultimately it contributes to a reference that I need to have for a business case going forward. So that's another objective. It's also good for this person to know. So creating clarity within a project is essential. And we see often that because there's no clarity, we interpret the objectives of the other party, and that is not always aligned with each other. Then, so that's a root cause why things often go wrong, and it's an important one. Role modeling is also important because, and it's also different in the different parts of the world, but if you are working with a lot of people in your project, and the project manager, as a leader of the team, his behavior is copied by the team members as well. So that means that if this team leader or this team manager is doing things which are probably are ethical, discutable, then probably this is notified by the employees and they are just copying his behavior and because they think that this is the right thing to do. And it's not always that it's true. It's also about perception. So, for example, if you think that your leader is behaving in the wrong way, although he's behaving in the right way, but if your perception is that he is behaving in the wrong way, then you might be copying his behavior as well. So it's not always the truth. It's about perceptions, and perceptions you can measure. And that's important to know. And that's what we also do in projects to steer behavior in companies. Of course, it's also important to have support from your employees in the projects. If they feel connected to the project, if they are feeling connected to the company they work for, then there's less risk than if you have people that are just doing a job because they need the money on a weekly basis. Because then the connectivity with the project and then they are less passionate about contributing to making a success out of this. So it's also important to understand how much support is there within the group of employees or within the group of people that are working in the project towards the project. Because if you feel that it's less, then there's room for improvement and you can install mitigating actions there. Enabling empowerment, is that the degree to which employees are able to meet expectations regarding to their behavior. It's also an important one because if, for example, if you're willing to do so, but for example, you don't have the time to do it, then you make a shortcut. So organizing your environment and stimulating that the environment is supporting you in your role is essential to do the things in the right way. So for the example that I sometimes give in a project is that there's, for example, no budget available to make a specific measure. That can be the case, but then people make shortcuts. And then, for example, you say you always have to check the background of the suppliers you're working with. Then, for example, a background check takes a lot of time, and maybe the systems that you need to do to perform a background check are not always available. Then you also make some shortcuts, or sometimes you just skip it because you cannot comply with this specific procedure, and that's also important. Then another one, which I think in projects is also very interesting, and that's transparency, and that's also the perception of transparency. And transparency is a little bit of a container word, but transparency, I always translate, is that the perception that you have that if you misbehave, that you will be caught. And that does not necessarily have to be true, but I can also imagine that you work in projects, often remote projects, far away, and that you think, nobody knows what I'm doing here. So nobody sees what I'm doing here. That doesn't mean that there's a risk, but there's increased risk that if there are other components happening, that people feel that they can get away with it. If transparency is very high, that you think, hey, everything I do is seen by others, then there's less risk that people ultimately misbehave. But if people really feel safe to do things, that doesn't mean that they do actually things wrong, but there's an increased risk. Now, so that's important as well. The other component, which is also important, is that there has to be, and especially in projects, is that there has to be a kind of an open culture to talk about dilemmas and to start discussing dilemma. Hey, I have a difficult situation. What do you think I should do? Instead of making your own decisions. If there is a culture that is not allowed to be vulnerable and to show your vulnerability because they expect you to make decisions, or people sometimes feel that they are not considered a professional if they don't make the decisions. Now, you're a better professional if you speak up and say, hey, I really would like to hear your opinion about this because I have an idea, but sharing this and having a safe environment to start discussing these types of dilemmas, difficult situations and projects, difficult decisions, also contributes to proper risk management and less risks. And of course, then also sometimes things happen and go wrong. Then also you should be comfortable to report this, because if you're afraid to report this, or you think, hey, this is not my responsibility to report this, it's his fault, I don't want to report it because otherwise I'm putting him on a blacklist, or that's not nice of me. Then it ultimately also contributes to probably an incident that ultimately runs into a bigger incident if it's not reported. So hopefully there's a safe environment, or there are some mechanisms that you can at least discuss this, preferably with the person that you see doing things in the wrong way, so that you can call somebody to account and say, hey, what are you doing? Because I see things happening and I'm not sure whether this is right. And that's the best way, direct, if that fits into your cultural environment, because I also understand that that's I'm from the Netherlands, and I think the Dutch are very famous for their directness, but that doesn't work in all countries. But having a kind of a mechanism that is safe to report misconduct is essential, because otherwise it stays under the table too long, and then it grows, and then it runs into something which is unmanageable. Yeah, and the last element is enforcement. And enforcement is two ways. So giving compliments to people that actually doing the right thing, that's important. That's also enforcement. But also punishing people that misbehave multiple times and taking the necessary actions. But we also see quite a lot of things happening in the Netherlands, for example, that there were people actually misbehaving quite a lot of times, but nobody took action. And then you also have the consequence that people working within this team, seeing this and seeing that people actually are misbehaving, yeah, they think, okay, if he's not punished, then maybe it works like that. So I have to copy this behavior as well. And that's also what you would like to add. So enforcement is also very important to organize. Okay, going to the next slide, because I really spent some time on explaining this scientific model very extensively. Now I can do it a little bit shorter. Ultimately it's that you have to create a kind of a risk culture in the organization to deal with the internal and external challenges. And I truly believe that policies and procedures really work well. But if your culture is right, then basically you don't need policies and procedures. If everybody's behaving in the right way, you don't need double signatures, because then everybody goes in the right direction. Of course, that's not the world that we live in. So we need policies, procedures, but these need to be to guide and to facilitate people to do the right things. But it all comes back to the culture, and a good culture really drives performance. So what we see in successful projects and successful teams, if you focus on a sound risk culture, you see that they are the most and the best performing teams. Also projects that where there's a common goal, where there's a common culture, there's really a push and a drive, the performance is the highest over there. That's also what you see in sport teams. If the culture in a soccer team is really great, or in another team, a rugby team, you know, if there's a, then the performance goes up as well. Of course, it also works on engagement, so you feel more connected to the project, so you really are dedicated to make it a success. But also, it contributes to agility. So because on your way, there's a lot of risks that you don't know yet. So if you have a culture which is really strong, then you also know that if a risk comes in, that you can discuss it, that it's safe, that you can deal with that. So it creates more flexibility and more agility in your team. And of course, your change behavior is increasing. And also, this is what the community, the society is also expecting from you, because they like successful projects. They like alignment with stakeholders. They like alignment with society or other parties that are involved in these projects. And that's what you see. So, and that's, I think that's an important driver for a successful project and a successful organization as well. Then to the next slide, please. So how can you work on that and what can you do with that? That's pretty easy. And I like to use the words, maybe to the next slide, because we are still on the same slide. Going to the next slide with soft controls approach. Yeah, that one. So having a sound soft controls or risk culture starts with a few steps. And I like to repeat those. The first one is that you have to make it clear. You have to make clear what you expect from the people. You have to explain what is expected in the project, what are the common objectives, what's my contribution to that, what's your contribution to that. Create clarity. But then you also have to make it known. So, okay, it's nice that you write it on paper, that you put it on a website, that you write a document, but you have to work with your people that they actually understand it and that they really feel it, that they breathe it. Then you also have to make it real by bringing in examples. Okay, but what will happen if you go into that situation? So make it real. Don't make it too theoretical. Now make it real on a case-by-case basis. And also use real examples to translate what you expect from the people. So make it real. Then, of course, make it happen. That's actually doing it. And also make it stick means that you have to continuously pay attention to it and measure it. And that's what we actually do in organizations. We measure the culture in a project on a continuous basis. And of course, there's always something to improve. But by doing that and having those conversations and doing that with all the stakeholders in the project, there's no way to escape. And then the common objectives and the noses in the same direction, that's what I manage. And often when I'm participating in a project, I call myself a mediator in between a married couple that decided to get married, but now are fighting each other. That's what you often see in projects. Different people in different companies in a project fighting each other, project owner, project taker, fighting each other. I'm trying to be the middleman. And by doing this, with this approach, there's no way to escape because there is a common goal. We have a project to finish. We really would like to make this happen. There are different objectives, different stakes that people have in the project. But by making it clear, making it known, really be dedicated, making it real and making it happen, then we really can work on those projects. And that's definitely something where I see that now the world is going to. So we cannot include and add new rules, new regulation, that will happen. But increasing the number of rules and regulations doesn't necessarily contribute to control to projects bettering control. You have to balance hard controls and soft controls. And I really would like to end with how I started. I said soft controls are hard and hard controls are soft. And why do I say that? Soft controls are cultural elements. If I call you or somebody to account and say, hey, what are you doing? Because I see you doing something which I don't think is right, the right thing to do for the project. that's impactful. That's hard. That's really something to do. So, and it's also not that easy. But so soft controls, cultural elements, is hard. It gets into your stomach. It can be sensitive. And a hard control, so policies and procedures, segregation of duties, all these policies and procedures are soft because often they are not solving the problem. They often create additional problems. So therefore, hard controls are also soft. And hopefully you will be able to manage those and to balance those because that ultimately contributes to the project. Okay, that's it for now. That's what I wanted to contribute today. Hopefully this resonates. I talked now for almost an hour, almost even more than an hour. And we have a lot of time for Q&A. So probably we open up for questions and more than happy to answer those. And I also believe that there are some colleagues of me in the call as well to support me in that. Are there some questions?
Thank you so much, Bart. Well, I'm back again online. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Excellent. Okay, so let me just switch back. So this is now the Q&A time. There are some good questions. I would love to share them with you. Let me start first. Can I check with Vivek if we are able to bring in the panelists, the additional panelists that Bart would like to invite into the webinar?
Hi, Mazen. The invites have been sent out. We should be able to hear from them if they are here in the session. But looks like so far they haven't been able to join.
I would just follow up on that while I throw the questions out to Bart. Just
yeah, okay. I will do. I'll do my best.
To the audience as well, there was some noise. We're just trying to mute myself. My kids have been very noisy, so apologies for that. I've been trying to hide from them, but we're getting the hang of this new platform. apart from that, let me start you with the first question, and I'm starting from the last one. He said, from Keith Hutchinson says, Bart, what would be your opinion and feedback on barrier-based risk methodology and how it fits into DRA?
I have to see what you really mean with the barrier base, because I'm probably not that familiar with that term, but I think that's more around what is within the boundaries, so it's that you go for certain boundaries and that you only approach a certain risk when it crosses a certain level. I think it really fits well in DRA. I think the classical risk management and the approach you can still continue to do and to use. DRA is just a method to improve your risk landscape. So you have your risk landscape, classical way, impact likelihood. But then you include risk clusters. But then after that, you also have to define your risk appetite, what kind of measures you take, and what are the barriers that you want to that you would like to cross. And so that can be included, but then you have to have a kind of a discussion. Okay, what are the limits that you expect around a certain risk cluster? So not only about an individual risk, then you focus on the risk clusters. Hopefully that answers the question.
Excellent. Thank you, Bart. And Keith, if you want to elaborate further on that, please go ahead into the questions and add more elaboration. But thank you so much, Bart. So let's start. I don't know if you can see my screen. Avinash Batil asking you, Bart, can a risk cluster be considered a separate risk and treated accordingly to achieve what we are trying to do here?
Yeah, absolutely. And that's... So what we normally do is, separate risk is maybe not the right word, but as you say, you can see it like that. So a risk cluster. What we do in risk dynamic risk assessment is that you identify the five or six the most important risk clusters, And then your mitigating actions will not be on individual risks, but only on the risk clusters. So you define your mitigating actions around the risk cluster. So de-escalating the trigger and putting some measures in place for the receiving risks. And if you do that, for example, if you have, for example, three risks in a cluster and you know that one very important risk is really triggering the other risks, and then you, for example, can only put a mitigating measure on that specific individual risk, but and then you know that the other two risks will be de-escalated, which means that you don't have to put additional measures on these individual risks, also reducing the cost of control for your total risk risk management. So that that's the way how you should deal with it.
Just switching between audio, mute, and the question, so forgive me for that. Taib, thank you so much for that elaborative answer, Bart. Next question I have, let me just click on the star so it becomes to the focal point.
I can see them as well. So I can see them.
Do we need to quantify connectivity in order to establish overall risk exposure? And if yes, how can we do it?
Yeah, good question. The quantification that we currently do is currently the strength of the connectivity. So, and that's an easy way to do because there's a mathematical approach under the hood. So you don't see that. So we are not going to bother our clients with that because there's a lot of thinking in it. But how we normally do it in projects when we use this types of approaches is that we just ask the individuals in the project team, and they are selected in a certain way to connect the risks where they see that the risks are connected, bi-directional. So we ask, okay, what triggers one risk? And if you have, for example, 20 risks, we go through all those 20 risks and we try to connect them with the other 19 risks. So that's the math that we do. That's not a quantification about the actual exposure. That's a separate approach, but I think it's a fair question. And that's also where I'm working on quite heavily, because often now we have a discussion, especially now in the COVID situation. If you spend, for example, 200 million on cyber prevention, cyber risk prevention, the question is, okay, what's the value at risk? Is it worthwhile to invest 200 million euro or dollar for a mitigation program if the risk in itself is not impacting 200 million to the company or to the project? And that quantification is more and more introduced into risk management, also in projects. But that's often the next step. We see the financial institutions see quite a lot of quantification aspects, but they are often based on models. And hopefully I have explained that models which use historical data to quantify is not always the best thing to do, because the future is completely different. So if you use models based on the past, then it doesn't work in quantification. And that's the problem also with quantification. If you do financial risk management, then you need historical data to quantify. And that's, so we are now searching for a new way to do that. And dynamic risk assessment is definitely a way forward to bring that in.
Excellent, excellent. I think you can still hear me. Perfect. Okay, moving on to the next question from Hussam Al-Malih. So basically Sam is asking, in terms of facing risk clusters, the risk traceability matrix used as part of the two-dimensional impact likelihood analysis can also be used. In this case, is this adaptation headed in the direction of dynamic assessment?
Yep. Yeah, so you're pretty right. So the risk clusters, bringing together the combined risks, so the individual risks, but as a combination, you put them basically on an impact severity or impact likelihood picture, because you definitely would like to know, okay, what's the impact and what's the combined impact and what's the combined velocity and what's the combined severity of the risk? And then you see that also individual risks which are combined, you don't have to add severity and impact together, because there's a mathematical method, and that goes really into depth. But sometimes you see, and those are the strongest risk clusters, that the risks that are connected with each other, that have an increased level of severity and impact, those are the risk clusters that you really would like to focus on, because these are the events. If they happen, then they even increase in magnitude when they happen in a sequence, and that's how we deal with that. So absolutely, you're right. You put them on the two-dimensional scale again, but then as a cluster.
Elaborative and straightforward. Thank you much, Bob, for this. So moving on to the next question from Shahid Salim, and I want to comfort the audience. Every question we answer goes into the answered pocket. So bucket, we can always come back to it if needed. Shahid Salim asks, what are key risk indicators if dynamic risk culture is adopted? And does using dynamic risk model core risk indicators get less focused?
These are two questions. What you see more and more, and that's also something we are now investigating globally as well. So behavioral economics is an important driver as well. So we have connectivity, which my colleague went to university and he also found out that that's an important one. But also it seems to be that decision making, it's not always rational. So there's a lot of irrational decision making, and that's behavioral economics. Daniel Kahneman, maybe you are familiar with his name. He won the Nobel Prize on behavioral economics. That's definitely an element that we are now also considering to further include in our approach. What we're currently doing is that within the risk clusters, we see, for example, that a weak culture or an unsafe environment can also be, in combination with some other risks, be a trigger within a risk cluster. So we definitely use soft controls or risk cultural elements in risks, but then we see it as an individual risk, but then it's often combined in those risk clusters. And that's what we try to inventorize when we do an assessment, to see what the connectivity is of specific cultural elements that are part of the, for example, if there's a lot of pressure on people to perform, or if there's a lot of pressure on people to, for example, you can be a project manager and you can just have had a bad annual review for yourself on your year-end review. And then maybe your leader is saying, okay, this will be your last project and it has to be a successful project because otherwise you have to search for another job. So that immediately gives a lot of pressure to the individual, also driving individual behavior. That you really would like to know because that can trigger a lot of events. It's often under the surface and often not known to a lot of people, but that's something, talking about clarity and organizing clarity and discussability, that should be considered in combination of other risks that are happening. But often these are not considered. And then when I do an investigation, when things go wrong, then it appears to be that that's the real root cause why things go wrong. And that's what you would like to have included in your risk discussion when you talk about individual risks. And then you can bring them into the risk landscape. And then if you have them in the risk landscape, you can connect those within the risk clusters. Hopefully that answers the question.
Absolutely. Excellent. Anything to add? Sorry, Bart, I must have heard you. Are you good?
No, I was just taking a
sip. Okay, good. Take a sip. Let me just quickly touch point with Vivek to check on our wonderful panelists, Rajiv, Sunil, or Archimedes. If they join us, please speak, declare yourself. Continue with the questions. Maybe not. Okay. Not a problem. Continuing, Bart, with the questions, and I know Vivek is trying to get in touch with them. Okay, so the copy of the presentation, with your permission, Bart, can we share that with the audience in PDF absolutely. Format?
Yeah, absolutely. So, of course. Excellent.
Much appreciated. That's an easy question. Okay, good. I have the second question, or the next question, from Mahmoud Asad. Stakeholders' risks can delay the project program portfolio, though continuous, effective, and proactive stakeholder engagement can help in predicting and managing such risk. But what about the unforeseen stakeholders who appear prior to the end of the project and could lead to stop or cause changes? How can we deal with them?
Yeah, that's a good one. That's the difficult one, because especially so if you say who appear prior to the end of the project, if you're not aware of them, then it's very difficult to take them on board. But that's exactly what you do in risk assessments, and also I explained to you the concept of expert elicitation. I think it's a good thing to do is to identify the people that you really would like to have involved in this risk assessment. And then maybe it's not always the most common people that you would like to have in the same room or participating in the assessment. Maybe you should also invite other stakeholders, or people that are a little bit lower in the organization, or that probably are bringing up these types of potential risk, or potential identify the potential stakeholders that some of us didn't think about, because there are, what I try to explain here is that probably there was somebody in the project team already aware of those stakeholders, but he was not asked. So it's important to facilitate them as well, and also opening up that if you really encourage risk management throughout the project, that you also encourage people to speak up and say, hey, if you think that we are missing something in risk management that you think we should consider, please bring this up as well. And probably and hopefully, and of course it goes in time because people need to have experience and more experiences, that's something that can happen. But you know, something that happens completely after the event, very unforeseen, a person which you're not familiar with or is connected to somebody else, or that's always difficult. But then you have to have the agility to deal with the situation.
Excellent. Right. Moving on. Bilal Namrud asking a question. Let me bring it to the focus. Do we have a general DRA matrix available, a one that covers the four dimensions, similar to the one we follow for routine risk assessment?
I don't know what you mean with a general DRA matrix. Of course, the matrix is there, so we have, but from a content perspective, we don't have a standardized, so we have a matrix which is empty, because I like to start a risk assessment with DRA with an empty plate. And then I include the top 20 risks that have been identified already by the project team. 20 is the maximum that I like to work with. More is more complicated. So if I have more risks, then we focus and then we try to combine a few of those risks. And that's how I use it. If the risks are not identified yet, then this is part of the approach. The DRA is basically the step in between having already identified risks towards identifying risk clusters. That's where it comes in. And of course, if there's already a top 20 risks, risk overview or risk landscape available, then of course, as part of the process, you validate those risks and you you're trying to understand those risks, and often in the process, new risks pop up or risks will fall off. But that's how we deal with it.
Bart, this is Archie speaking. Can you hear me?
Yeah, absolutely, Archie. Good to hear you.
Hey, Mazin, if I may, I think it's very relevant questions from you. Every risk network is unique. I think we have to stress that in mind. Well, in fact, in every DRA project that we perform, we have to build the risk skills, first of all, and it has to be unique for every organization. So that being said, creating a uniform network that applies for many companies is kind of difficult, although we try to build it as well on the industry level. I think that's one of the suggestions that we can take forward as well.
Yeah.
Addition, Archie, and if you would like to introduce yourself, I would love to have you also give you some time as a manager in risk advisory at KPMG Netherlands, but please do add to it if you like.
Thank you so much, Mazin. Indeed, I'm part of Bart Van Loon's team as well. A little bit of difficulties getting in with the connection and stuff, but I'm glad to be part of this conversation. So happy to join.
Thank you much. Big fan of your name, by the way, Archimedes. Okay.
Thanks for that.
He's also currently in Indonesia, so he's also... not far away now, so
absolutely. So I just want to celebrate that, actually, for our audience to know that Bart is calling from Netherlands and Archie is calling from Indonesia. Is that right?
That's correct, okay. Indeed. Yeah,
thank you so much, really much appreciated. That's a really treasure to have. Okay, moving on to the next question. Sean Meadows is asking, can DRA be applied effectively to positive risks opportunities as well as negative risks? I see one of the worst human behaviors in projects is the missing of opportunities due to the very poor risk culture in terms of opportunities. For example, opportunities seen as having no benefit or reward to project team members, as one example.
Yeah, this is close to my heart. This is exactly what we also experiencing when we talk about risk management and do it in a DRA approach, because often it shows a lot of opportunities as well, because those risk clusters also identify opportunities. And our philosophy is that risk management is just one side of the coin, because the risk is always has a positive and a negative element to it. And that's what... So entrepreneurship is basically dealing with risks. And if you do that in the right way, then you have an opportunity and a great business model. If you have to mitigate the risks, then it's risk management. And these come close together. So what we see from a strategy perspective is that we also working very closely to strategy officers. And as we speak, we are also thinking about repositioning risk management within organizations. Because I fully agree, it's also about identifying the opportunities and organizing that you do that you deal with them in the right way. So and what we see when we use DRA, it also, for example, I recently had a discussion with some senior management about a specific risk cluster, and then we identified that the weak IT system that they had was one of the most important triggers to trigger a very important risk cluster. And this also drove an opportunity, because what we do within a normal company is that we allocate the most important risk and the risk cluster to the CEO, because the CEO ultimately is the owner of the company, and he should own the most sensitive triggering risk. And this IT system was weakest IT system is was the most important risk. So we allocated this specific risk to him, and we also discussed with him, hey, this is a huge opportunity for you, because if you can change the sign of this potential risk, for example, by changing your weakest IT system towards the best IT system ever, then it also creates the huge opportunity also from a competitive perspective. a bit, because also your competition is not strong in this. And so that, so within the risk cluster, it can drive opportunities, but also from a job opportunity perspective, you can also deal with that. So, yeah, absolutely. Good question. Very good question.
Any addition, or you shall we go ahead?
No, I agree with Bart. We talk about the most influential risk once again, as Bart said. And if we turn that part into the opportunity, you can literally influence all other risk in the network. Like inadequate response to COVID, for instance, for many companies, it becomes the most influential risk. If we just think it from the other way around, the other side of the coin, if you're the first company to, you know, shine in the midst of the COVID, then we can turn that literally into the opportunity. So yes, that's the beauty of the RA.
Thank you much. The next question is from Hussam Al-Malih. In terms of change orders, which are common for lump sum contracts, this is simply a case of contracts being signed well before risks have been properly identified, which in a way can, but should not, be excused as inevitable. How can this lump sum culture be migrated to new types of contract that are easier to audit?
That's also close to my heart as well, because I had a lot of conversations also with project owners, like the Dutch government, who's giving quite a lot of projects to construction companies, and construction companies are struggling with that because they want to win it, so they immediately subscribe for a lower amount, trying to exclude quite a lot of risks and bring it back in. So that's not always the best way to do so. And once they have won the contract, they immediately start having those types of discussion. Hey, we didn't take this into account. This we didn't know. And also the Dutch government in this case doesn't like that as well. So they are trying. As a matter of fact, we are now in a kind of a situation where the Dutch government invited also all the construction workers to really talk about how to solve this going forward. But that's typically Dutch. I think opening up this discussion up front is necessary, because otherwise I think we are stepping into a project and we already know what the outcomes will be, because we know that there will be overruns in quality, or lower in quality or higher in cost. And also sometimes the time to complete the project will also be higher. That's definitely something I think in a professional context you should be able to discuss that upfront. But that's not always possible. And at the same time, we also know that, for example, some very prestigious projects would never have started if the real costs and the real risks were considered upfront. So also there we know that if the train starts rolling, it's difficult to stop. So they just start the train rolling, and then on our way, we will experience. And then it's often difficult to stop a project because that costs also a lot, and then you don't have anything, and then you just continue. So that's a kind of a dilemma. But discussing those dilemma upfront and being transparent in that, that's the most easy thing to do. But in a competitive environment, it's not all that easy. I don't have an answer to you on that, because if I had, then I think I would have a solution for a lot of problems. But that's the way how we deal with that, I think. I'm not sure whether my other MPA colleagues like Sunil and Rajiv are in the call, because they might be able to add to that as well. But
we're still trying,
because
to
I can only
in connection.
Okay, with... because I'm trying.
Go ahead.
Okay. Because I do it from a Dutch context, and I know that there's in the UAE probably it's different, and I don't know the details on how you contract and how the competition is in your region.
Sure. I can definitely park this and definitely Hussam Al-Malih to send it to me directly, and I will forward it to Bart and the rest, Rajiv and Sunil, if you like. So I hope some Hussam could hear us and has taken a note of that, right? Okay, perfect. Moving on. Next is Nahid Sayed, or Saeed. As she says, as DRA can be quiet, unpredictable in an agile environment, how can it be compatible with other approaches such as FEMA or FMEA to at least track for such risks like the current one as COVID-19 and any other risks? Plus, how can we keep up to speed with the business impact analysis that overlap with DRA? So it's a two-part question, I believe. Go ahead.
Yeah, it's about the agility and the flexibility, because as we speak in the Netherlands, we have a kind of a discussion what the added value of a risk manager is, because they basically say, you know, they're always too late and after the event, so maybe we should get rid of them, and then we still have the same issues. And part of the discussion, which I'm also participating in, is that, yeah, the reason why we are always delayed is that we are trying to use techniques which are old-fashioned and outdated and not always close to where the action is. So if you organize that risk management is just part of your day-to-day decision-making, then it can be very flexible. And of course, the dynamic risk assessment approach is a kind of an exercise that you have to do, but and you don't have to repeat that every week, not every month, and also not every half a year, right, depending on what type of dynamics you are in. But even in the earthquake gas transition project, which is quite intense in the Netherlands and is changing quite rapidly, we still feel that the risks that we have identified are still valid. And also there, because we did this assessment before COVID, we also identified a huge event coming in, which distracts the political attention to that event, like COVID now, and also putting away the attention from this earthquake transition project, also resulting to specific risks. So, but we also encourage people to really assess and understand, okay, what are the risk clusters? Are the risk clusters still in place? What's the actual situation doing? What's the impact on the risk clusters that we currently have? And should we, because risk management is what you have to do on a day-to-day basis, and it's not an exercise that you do on paper with an impact likelihood assessment, and then you have a nice paper and you put it away, and then you do a risk assessment the month after again. No, risk assessment is continuously working with the risks and to see whether the environment is changing or not. And that's, I think that's something which has to change in the behavior if you want to have an agile or a effective risk management in a fast changing environment. For example, so I can, I think COVID is a nice one because we have got a lot of discussions. There are quite a lot of organizations that identified a pandemic as a specific risk, especially after SARS in Asia. This risk was identified by quite a lot of companies as a specific risk that could happen to them as well. But a lot of companies decided to, after a while, to take that out because, you know, it was a long time ago, SARS, so it was not taken into consideration anymore. But there are other companies that used risk clusters, the DRA approach, that still combined the risk of a pandemic into their risk landscape. And we can still say that these organizations survived better because they were better prepared, and they still have the economic consequences of this pandemic because it impacted quite heavily everywhere. But they were better prepared. They were more agile to deal with the situation because they had business continuity programs in place that save them basically. So and they also spread activities around the globe, so that they were not dependent on one specific part of the world that where it was in a lockdown. For example, China in the first instance, like for example Apple, they really immediately had a problem because China came into lockdown. Like IKEA, they also had a problem because production facilities closed down immediately. So, it contributes to agility, but not to the rest.
Excellent, Archie. If there is anything you want to add.
No, nothing from my side.
Excellent. So next question is, how can AI and data analysis be helpful in DRA? By Sadiq.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, good question. It's included. Although it's under the hood, so we do a lot of data analytics by clustering those risks. So if we ask... because we use a certain tool for that, and there's mathematics behind it. So I'm not going to bother you with that, but there's a lot of scientific models behind it. But the clustering of risks and also the way how all the assessments that we do globally are brought together also has some predictive elements in it. We don't use it as a... as I mentioned, it's under the hood because I like to have normal discussions with project owners about certain risks, and I don't want to come up with complex data models and those kind of things. I want to talk about, okay, this is the specific risk and this is how you have to manage it. But under the hood, there's data analytics a lot in it, and also artificial intelligence.
I'm just looking for my mute. So we have 8 minutes. Going on to the next question. And Archie, please jump in whenever you feel like. The next question is to the following statement. Is this framework also useful for opportunity management? My question is from an enterprise risk management perspective rather than from a project perspective.
Yep. Yeah, I think we covered this already. Because it's both sides of the coin, so definitely you can use the technique also looking at opportunities. As I am in the area of risk management, I only focus mostly on managing risk and using DRA for that. But I know that some of my colleagues also use the same approach into opportunity. Management, but that's not that common. So we don't receive quite a lot of those requests. But the principle is basically the same.
Okay, excellent. Swiftly moving into the next question by Hussam Al-Malih. Is, in your experience in advisory services, are organizations that do incorporate environmental and CSR initiatives doing so with success, or are they facing roadblocks from their clients or regulators?
Yeah, absolutely. Probably they face roadblocks from clients and regulators. On the other hand, I'm a little bit critical on the environmental and CSR initiatives that are taken, because often the driver, and probably that's because of clients, they are not willing to pay for it. They are still doing it in the old-fashioned way. What we're experiencing now in the Netherlands is that because of the old-fashioned way of working, we also have some measures by the government that it's not allowed to work on projects anymore because of the it's not pollution. Archie, you have to help me again with that word, stickstoff.
Nitrogen.
Nitrogen. So we have too much of those nitrogen pollution in the Netherlands, and that which resulted into ceasing large projects to finalize. And of course, it gives a lot of noise and a lot of discussion in society, especially from the construction workers. But we didn't make decisions and choices a few years ago, and now we have a problem because we are above certain limits, and even the European Union is now restricting the Dutch government to go further in this. So we all have to drive 100 kilometers an hour because we are not allowed to drive faster because of all of this, and also the construction projects have been stopped for a moment. And I think also there's a huge amount of responsibility within projects to really fundamentally change this, and also looking at it from an life cycle perspective. So it's not only coming from a cost perspective, it's often cheaper to come with a specific solution. But if it's in a life cycle, better to make a huger, a larger investment now because the maintenance costs will be less, and also the impact on the environment is less. Then I think these are decisions that nowadays have to be taken. But I think it's difficult. My wife is in sustainability, so it's very close to me. And my wife basically says, you know, we just have to happen till we now have COVID, but we also expect that the climate impact will be huge as well. So if we lose, for example, a certain island because of the water increase, the sea level increases, or for example, in Australia, where we have those fires, but those bushfires, I think there will be more events happening. And I'm afraid that's ultimately the trigger of the events that we have to deal with, and then the solution will come in. But I hope that that society is already doing these things in order to prevent these large events from happening. But and you also see that COVID also results into in a society which is pretty agile, that we are all working from home and that we all work remotely, and that I'm now doing a presentation via internet in the office in Amstelveen to you. Yeah, in the past we would have said, that's impossible because we would like to have day-to-day contact. It's all possible. Right? So, and I also think that in CSR and in environmental topics, everything is possible, but we just have to do it. And yeah, that's also a plea towards you. Hopefully you can do that as well. But I understand that clients and regulators sometimes are a burden.
Thank you, Bart. Archie, do you have any final thoughts, I think, in the last 2 minutes?
No, I don't have any other thoughts than what Bart just indicated. I'm curious about the next questions, though, if we still have time.
We can answer them if you like. We might just go over time, but let me know. I'm going to limit you to a minute each. So let's go to Carl Griffiths and then finish with Nassim Abed, if that's okay. Carl Griffiths asks, so the core concept is that certain risk probabilities are not independent and are potentially changed if another risk materializes. So I suppose you would have to run scenarios and try to identify how the risk profile for each risk changes depending on how the environment changes, right? And the solution for building these scenarios and risk planning is Delphi. That does not sound very robust. What are your thoughts?
Very interesting questions, right, Carl? Well, we didn't really talk about the complete trajectory of ERA here. Bart mentions about expert early stations, obviously, so it does sound like Delphi all in all. But I wanted to add that in that process, we only take the experts early stations methodology at the beginning from a number of experts, and then we will take them to the larger workshop where approximately 16 to 20 people will be there, considered as an expert from the project teams. And we also introduce another measure there, like introducing structural breaks, which essentially take the participants to another type of environment where they can think outside of the box. And then there's another step again, where we have to invite them to the tool and they have to start connecting all those risks. And basically to make some clusters and see whether a certain type of risk will connect to the networks and so on and so forth. So yes, there is that Delphi element there a little bit, but however, we also embed another quantitative approach in this case when we make the clusters with the network theory, and also when we make the centrality assessments. That's also another mathematical methodology that we put so much effort behind it to develop the past few years, actually, if you call it one the past decade. So that's how I respond to Carl. If Bart has another response to that, maybe Bart.
I think it's perfect. Perfect answer, Archie. Thank you.
Yeah.
The last question by, thank you so much, Archie. The last question by Naseem. Some argue that controlling risk is a cat herding exercise and propose agility as the way forward. So risk management becomes an exercise of abandoning elaborate pre-planning and keeping an eye, open eye on the assumptions and reacting fast to changes. How realistic is this approach in your opinion?
That's a nice one. And I'm okay with that partly. But we also experience that the complexity of the environment that where we live in is also increasing. And it also means that as an individual, it's very, very difficult to oversee everything. So that means that you have to have a kind of an approach to facilitate the fact that you need to have information about other things from happening and how that interrelates and interconnects with with your risk assessment and the decision making that you're going to do. And the information that you need to absorb as an individual is more complex. So just saying that you just go with the flow, doing it in an agile way, open-minded, etc., that works, but you have to install something that supports you, basically fuels you with the relevant information, and then a certain approach might help.
Excellent. Bart and Archie, I really appreciate also, I mean, the interest that you have generated for this with this audience in this topic specifically. I think the topic has aroused and excited a lot of minds and brains in this audience. I want to personally thank you. Let me just remind everybody that, guys, Bart Van Loon is actually available on LinkedIn. If you are interested also in getting connected with Archimedes, I have his LinkedIn. I've already sent him a LinkedIn invite. Please get in touch with me or anybody from the volunteers community and PMI, and we will connect you also with the KPMG crew. I really want to appreciate and thank everybody who has been speaking today, our guest speakers all the way from Holland and our panelists from Indonesia, for giving us the time and the courtesy for sharing their amazing knowledge and the depth of experience to be shared upon this forum. For anybody who would be interested in speaking, please note down this email address. We welcome everybody. Don't forget to follow us on the email address and as well as on the social media platforms. With this, I would like to thank our speakers first and foremost, our panelists, and our wonderful audience for making this an unforgettable learning experience. Thank you, Bart, and thank you, Archie. Thank you, everybody. Good night. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you very much. And.